Thank you very much, Sarah, and Happy New Year to everybody. I think we may be one of the only few companies that was disappointed to see 2020 come to an end. It was really a spectacular year for us and a very busy year for the team. So what I'd like to do today or this evening is walk you through where we're at, what's happened in the past year, and then where we see that going forward, and should give you a pretty good oversight of where we're at, although there will still, so I'm sure, be lots of questions to ask. This picture that you see on here gives you a pretty good indication. This is our location. I believe that's our Chinook location, which is, you know, basically in the jungle in Trinidad, but very accessible. So it gives you an idea of the area that we're in. The four pillars that we look at from our corporate point of view is operating responsibly. That, you know, we really see that as our ESG, and I'll touch on that with a couple of slides. Exploration upside. Certainly, there's lots of exploration upside left in what we have, although we've now been successful on 4 for 4 for exploratory wells. Talk about how we can scale that economic growth. And then the final part is the value creation and what we see is in that for the shareholders as we go forward. Start out a little bit with the operating responsibly. You know, we've got 85% of our workforce is in Trinidad. We basically have all of our operations down there are operated by locals. No expats in the country on the operational front. We do bring in a couple of experts to help us drill some of these tricky wells, but besides that, it's virtually all locals. We've got a very good environmental run that we've had, and considering that we operate a number of wells, over a couple hundred wells in Trinidad, you know, that's, I think, a big accomplishment for the team. And certainly our recordable incidents, both with us and our consultants, is well below what the industry strives for. So we continue to move forward on that. And I think we're going to leave Trinidad in a lot better place than when we showed up from an operational point of view. During COVID, and we've had lots of questions about this, you know, one of the benefits of Trinidad is that it's an island, and they basically just shut the island down from people coming in and out. And it's actually worked out exceptionally well. They did have a bit of a surge, but the cases have remained very low. And it's really been an opportunity for us to do a few things that we can do. It's tested all of our people on the island, but we've been able to continue to operate as we've gone forward. Some unique things that we've done, we've been able to take and distribute about 460 hampers to various families down there. There's not quite as good a safety net in Trinidad as there is in some of the other parts of the world. So some direct support has been great. And just one of the little examples of one of the things that we do, which is really, you know, an example, it isn't a big thing, but we try to find specific things in the areas we operate in that we can help. And we had a request from one of the schools that was going to online learning, but they had a number of students that didn't have laptops, and we were able to supply those to them. And I think we were able to shame a couple of the other producers in the area to help out too, and that need's now been met. So yeah, we're pretty active in the community, and the team's done a great job in the COVID era. Move on to the land holding side of things. We really have two different areas that we talk about. One is our development acreage, which is really our legacy oil production. And that production currently is paying all the bills. And it's basically, it pays all the G&A, all the overhead, all those things. And at current prices, I'm sure it's cash flowing positive, and you'll see that in our year-end numbers. But the block that I think is created the most interest is really that Oratoa block on the east side of the island, where we now have two discoveries. And I mentioned we actually have four exploratory successes, and I'll talk about them. Just before I hop off this map, what I'd like to point out is in the middle there's a red blob that is the central block. And that was the only major gas pool on the island before we started operating at Oratoa. And our premise was pretty simple. It doesn't make sense geologically that this would be the only gas pool, big gas pool on the island. And it is a big gas pool. So I'll kind of walk you through how we go from there. Before I do that, just some basic geology on Trinidad and why we're there and why we like it so much. You can see that black circle is the Eastern Venezuelan Basin. Arguably, the Venezuelan Basin is the richest hydrocarbon basin in the world. And Trinidad just sits right smack in that basin. So we've got a great hydrocarbon system in what we see here. And then if you look at the yellow circle that's there, that's basically the same strike with what we've seen with Exxon doing in Guyana, lots of activity in Suriname, and arguably Guyana offshore has been one of the hottest areas to drill. the deposition that you see here on the right-hand side is just some sort of cartoons of distribution of what we see. It's not simple, but basically what's happened here is the sand has been shed off of the South American continent and been deposited in the deep waters a long, long time ago. And that's basically what we're drilling up are these things called turbidites, which are these big fan sequences that sit at the bottom of these geological areas. So just keep that in mind when you look at the map that we see going forward here. So this is our Oratois block, obviously our where most of our activity has been. But I'll start out by pointing out that central block that I talked about, which was the only major gas property on the island. You know, that property is just world class. It's going to produce 500 BCF and about 25 million barrels of liquids. It's been on for 20 years. It came on at 85 million cubic feet a day, and it is still producing at about 40, 45 million cubic feet a day. So it's just a wonderful field. And that's basically an analog to what we're looking at, analogous to what we're looking at on our blocks that we're looking at on the island. You can see Coho to the north, which was our first discovery, then Cascadura, Chinook, and then back at Cascadura was the fourth well. The next well we're going to drill is Royston, and I'll walk you through all of those prospects as we go. Two things to notice on this map is that red line going right through the middle of the map there is the main gas line that goes up to Phoenix Park Gas Facility, which is the main petrochemical business on the island in Trinidad. It's got about 500 million cubic feet a day of excess capacity in it right now. And the National Gas Company will be building a tie-in point into our Cascadura location and then a further tie-in to Chinook. And we just found out the other day that it looks like we're going to be looking at running probably about a 20-inch line, which will be capable of about 250 million cubic feet a day in there. So that kind of gives you an idea of what we think and what they think is the potential is in that particular area as we look. The other line that's through here is the green line that goes through the middle of the property. That's an oil line, and we'll be accessing that line. We'll probably build a line from Cascadura down to Chinook and then down to the Cat's Hill tie-in and tie-in our liquids down there. Depending on pressure, it's got about 4,000 to 8,000 barrels a day of capacity. So initially it'll be lots for us, and we may have to figure out pressures as we move our project along a little bit further. But that's basically the map, and I'll walk you through in a little more detail here. So the exploration success we've had, the first well we drilled was Coho, and it was about 105 feet of net pay. This was always the smallest prospect, but we thought it was the lowest risk, so we did that one first. We then moved over to Cascadura and had some really good old well information and a really good 3D. And we were fortunate enough to move up structure, improve the location of that old well from the 1950s, and ended up with about 1,000 feet of pay. So, you know, a really dramatic increase. We moved south to another area called Chinook, and you can see at Chinook there, we ended up with about 609 feet of pay. I'll talk a little bit more about what's going on down there in a moment. We then slid back up to Cascadura. And the reason we went back to Cascadura is we weren't able to drill the original Cascadura as deep as we wanted to, just because the reservoir was giving us up too much gas, and for our safety purposes, we had to stop. We went back to Cascadura deep. We did get 2,000 feet deeper, and we did encounter almost another 300 feet of pay. But unfortunately, we ran into the same problem again, where we couldn't control the well. And so there is another sort of step change here at Cascadura, another well for us to drill. And we want to still try to get a well up in that area down to 10,500 feet. And we'll see that happen probably in early 2022. And the final prospect is Royston, and I'll talk about that in a minute. It's by far our largest prospect we had going into this. And, you know, it's going to make really exciting to drill in Q1 or Q2 of this year. Just go through these fairly quickly, but give you an idea of where we're at. So the Coho well, really good flowback. You know, it looks like a terrific well. It's 10 to 12 million cubic feet a day. Kind of give you an idea, the day it comes on production, it'll double our current production on a BOE basis. So it takes us from roughly 1,300-1,400 a day to almost 3,000. So, you know, that'll be a significant change. It'll generate about $500,000 net a month to the company, US dollars. We are still waiting for our final environmental approval on that. The latest that we've heard is that that should be in early February. And as soon as we've got that, then we can get in the field. It'll be about 45 to 60 days to get it on production from approval. So a little bit of a delay, but you know, we're continuing to push forward. And remember, this is the first gas that's been brought on in Trinidad in 20 years. So, you know, these are all sort of new processes that we're going through, but we are definitely making headway in the COVID era. The next well is the Cascadura well. We did two tests on this well. You know, really remarkable when you look at them. They were limited by surface equipment. The maximum we could really produce these at was that, basically that 5,500 BOEs a day and 85-86% natural gas. The rest are light liquids that we will be able to sell basically as oil. And you can see that right now our forecast is that that particular well from the one zone, which will be the upper test, will come on later this year, hopefully in the fourth quarter, but definitely by the end of the year. 40 to 50 million cubic feet a day with the associated liquids. So it'll add about 6,200 to 7,500 BOEs a day net. And you can see the reserves are just massive in this particular opportunity. We then went down to Chinook where we are right now. And we drilled that well to 10,039 feet. Ended up with a number of pay zones in there. We will be testing the first pay zone as soon as we can here. The delay has been the testers were doing some work for BP on an old pipeline, same type of equipment that we need for this particular project. And that project's just taken longer in logistics. And they are not going to be available till February 1st. So that's when we'll begin to test it. The good news, that's the bad news. The good news is that we were originally going to test Chinook and then go test Cascadura. We spoke this morning and what we'll likely do is do test one at Chinook, so the first zone at Chinook, then go up and while it's being shut in, test Cascadura and just kind of leapfrog the test unit back and forth between Chinook one and the next Cascadura well. So there'll be two tests at Chinook in the gas zones, and as I say, they'll commence in early February, so we should have results at the earliest mid February, but most likely late February from Chinook. The next well is Cascadura Deep. This is by far the best well that we've ever drilled in here. 1,315 feet of net pay. We're going to test probably do at least three zones in here, but I think it's very safe to say that you know those productive rates that we saw out of the first Cascadura well of 40 to 50 million a day are going to be the same kind of thing that we see out of Cascadura Deep. We're pretty comfortable to say that. So when you bring on Cascadura and Cascadura Deep, let's assume there's no success at Chinook. Between now and the end of the year, we'll be bringing on roughly 100 million cubic feet a day and 2,000 or 3,000 barrels a day of liquids. So lots of change coming forward as we go forward. And then in Q2, we'll be moving over to Royston with the drilling rig. This is a little bit further to the east. And basically, this remains a great prospect. I think, it's not very often you can go for 4 for 4 on exploratory. But we are moving to, a long ways away from where we are now. I get asked all the time as to, how confident are you in this? And I think we're confident, but again, these are exploratory wells. We do have an old well here. We've got good seismic. So we think we've got some good leads and bypass pay, but, I just continue to sort of caution everybody that these are exploratory as we go forward. However, the size of the prize here is really significant. It's something that probably on the low side, if we're right, it's probably 250 BCF, and on the upside, it's probably a TCF of gas if we're successful. But again, I just emphasize that it is exploration, and we're excited about it. But we kind of feel a little bit like we might be pushing our luck here with 4 for 4. But the team's done a really good job on the technology side, and so we'll continue to push forward. I should mention that just yesterday we actually got the environmental approval. So we have all the clearances we need to make Royston happen. Should be in the field starting to build that road very, very shortly and be on time for what we're doing there. So keep your fingers crossed on that one. And then on top of that, something that, is starting to lay out for shareholders in 2021 is where do we go from here? And I think what you can see is that's the block. We now have 21 additional exploration targets on that. And there are various different types of targets, but they're all within that same thick sand fairway. The arrows that you see on here are basically the anticlines or the highs that we've identified on seismic. And so it really does give us a multi-year program. The other point I should point out is that gray area under Royston is actually a deeper prospect that we see. It's called Cretaceous. And it's a very, very large prospect. And it's one that sort of the holy grail of Trinidad, they've been looking for it onshore for a number of years. And I think if we get a good well at Royston, we would then do a second well as a development well in the upper sands and take it down to the 15,000 feet down into the Cretaceous and take a look what's there. But it's very exciting, and it looks really good on seismic. So we want to definitely put that in the exploration category. Long and short is there's lots to do on this block. As we go forward, we now have the national gas contract in place, and I'm sure I'll get lots of questions on that one, but it's actually a very simple contract. It's a depletion contract. So basically all the gas that we find on that block goes to the national gas company. They're going to pay us a price that I can't tell you because I'm covered by an NDA. But if you take a look at the analysts that cover us, they're using an average price of about $2.50. An MCF, and I can confirm that that's a reasonable number to use. But the important thing about that number, the most important thing, and I'm not sure that everybody understands it, is there's virtually no deductions from that number because they build the pipelines right down to our plants. So it's basically going to be that 250 less the 12.5% royalty, less probably 5 cents of operating costs. And then all the rest goes into our genes. So I know talked about some of the other pricing earlier, and I really, hope everybody can kind of understand that the way we negotiated this deal, we have no liabilities. There's no take or pay. The capital that we have to spend to bring these wells on production is very minimum because they're building the pipelines. So all of our money basically goes into drilling wells and bringing on production. So it's a really unique situation. The gas goes to the petrochemical business, which is very high load factor gas, and there has been a lot of discussion about petrochemical business in Trinidad. It is smaller than it was before, but it is a very active business and going to be there for a very long time. So 10 years of development drilling program, a 10-year drilling program. I think you could see that from the previous slide where there was lots of opportunities. Something else to talk about today that we haven't talked about before is we're now in the application stage, and we're comfortable enough that we've applied for two additional surface locations at Chinook, as well as two additional surface locations at Cascadura. So there'll be actually four wells on each one of those locations. So we're now targeting four development locations for Cascadura and at least four development locations at Chinook. So we've now got this great balance of a development program and an exploration program that we see. And it is going to be a great benefit for us, the local community, and Trinidad as a whole. Won't talk about the legacy properties very much, although, with oil starting to move back into the mid-50s, these become very attractive again. We've got 10 producing fields. We've got 208 drilling locations there, and it's certainly something we can drop into the portfolio very, very quickly. I think we've got, four wells that are identified that we could get after right away. So you are going to hear more about that, especially as oil price continues to strengthen.
Okay, we're just overrunning a little bit, Paul.
Sure. Okay, I got one slide left, Sarah. So basically what we, on the funding side, we raised $30 million in November. So we're fully funded through to everything that I've shown you here through to first production at Cascadura. And, that's probably the biggest question on that particular slide. And that's it. We've got a good development program. We've got the exploration program. We've got a management team and a board that's been involved in companies much larger than this. And we're just excited to take it to the next level. And I apologize for going over.
That's okay. I knew you would. If you could go back to slide 14, please, just so that when we answer questions about the different assets, we can visualize them and see what the proximity is between each one. And you should know better than to sign an NDA before appearing on a proactive webinar. You are amongst friends, you can tell us. It won't go any further amongst the several.
Yeah, I've now learned that this isn't a closed loop here. So it's I think the reason for signing that NDA with the National Gas Company is they have a real tricky balance of being the aggregator on the island, and they want to make sure the petrochemical business sticks around. and is, you know, provides long-term employment, yet they want to get a good rate of return for us in the field to encourage us to keep drilling. So that's kind of the balance that they keep. So I'm comfortable with that.
Okay, and many thanks for looking after the community with those hampers over the festive period. And also, I understand that the COVID situation, the peak there was September, nothing like it is in the UK at the moment. Lots of investors saying, Paul, can we have another 2020 this year? That's how you started your presentation, was that the previous 12 months were pretty good. So I'm going to have a look at Thomas Hardy's question, which is very clever. He says, with all the good news regarding reserves, what do you perceive as the risks to bringing the fields in production and getting the gas to market?
Yeah, it's probably the most common question. And I think the biggest risk is just going to be timing. It's going to be getting the environmental approvals. You know, we've looked at Coho. We filed that first environmental application to tie in Coho back in May. And I think, Sarah, one of the first times you and I talked, we thought this production was going to be on in November. And, you know, it now looks like it's going to be on in March or April. So, you know, these things are taking longer. The only difference I can say now is that the national gas company is going to be building the pipelines instead of us. And the benefit is they, you know, they've got a better in to all of the government people being a Crown corporation than we do. You know, to give you an idea, they've already gone out, done a survey. They've put in a preliminary certificate, environmental compliance. So, you know, they've got a team to do this. And not only have there been no new gas come on in 20 years, our team had never applied for one of these either. So, you know, it was kind of a learning curve on both sides. So I'm hoping we can compress that. But in answer to the question really specifically, I think it's timing more than anything. You know, the nice thing about Trinidad is we've got pipeliners on the island. We've got lots of capacity. Petrochemical business is running every day. They're short of gas. So, you know, I think that's going to be our biggest challenge is just getting those environmental approvals and timing. And shareholders are just going to have to be patient because I know there's going to be bumps in the road along the way here on timing of this for sure.
Okay, because it's timings that's concerning a lot of the investors putting questions in. Fred Johnson asking, what are you doing to make sure we don't have a delay with the Cascadura and Chinook pipeline that we have experienced with the Coho pipeline?
Yeah, I think the couple of things that we've sort of learned in the Coho process was, you know, some of the paths of least resistance were, you know, going down existing roadways, going down existing right of ways, getting the forestry involved earlier, you know, a bunch of little things that we learned through Coho. But to be quite honest with you, the National Gas Company is much better equipped than we were to do this. And it's basically in their hands now. And I know it sounds crazy to say, I trust the government to do a better job than us. In this particular case, I do it. And their motivation is they're short of gas. They're short a ton of gas. And they need to get this gas on production, you know, as at least as badly as we do. So, you know, we're on the same side here.
Okay. In my introduction, I talked about that natural gas sales agreement. You were very loquacious when that agreement came out. You said the structure of the agreement would give a predictable cash flow and earnings stream for years to come. What are you going to do with all that cash? And some investors are wanting to know about dividends.
Yeah, I think it's a good question. And we've had that discussion at the board at our strategic meeting back in December. And you know, the first thing we want to do is drill up as many of these prospects as we can to make sure we, you know, get maximum value in what we're doing. And then, quite frankly, we've got to look at what to do with the excess cash. And one of the obvious things is to look at doing dividends. And, you know, Scott, our CFO, has obviously ran a bunch of models. But one of the beautiful things about this gas contract is you know what your price is going to be. So like we saw before, even with the Wentworth fixed price that we're talking about earlier, it's very similar in that sense, is it's a very predictable revenue stream. So we can kind of carve out what we want for dividends. And we will look at that. The two things need to happen is we want to get a test off on Chinook early in the year, and then we'll give good guidance for the remainder of the year because we'll know exactly where we are there. And when we get a little more clarity on when that Cascadura volumes are going to come on stream, then we'll talk about when we can look at dividends. But, you know, I'd like to have that conversation, a very serious discussion on that in early 2022.
Okay, so 12 months' time, that's what I'll be badgering you about. Now, I don't know if anyone's flirting with me, but this question has come to me only. I think it's supposed to be for you, but David Newlands asks, do you want to try the Cretaceous play and what sort of depth? So I think that's for you, not for me.
David, that Cretaceous play really is it really is exciting. It's and our confidence levels moved up because of the four exploratory successes we've had, but we've gone so far as to name it. So it's called Kraken, this mythical sea creature. So that kind of seems to fit with what we're looking at there. But it's at 15,000 feet, so it's about another 4,000 feet deeper than what we're drilling at Royston. But it is, it's on that same trend, quite frankly, as what we're seeing them Exxon and those parties drill up in Guyana and Suriname. So while we've got it and while we're there and we've got the equipment, I'd be really surprised if you don't see us taking a crack at that in our Kraken. Sorry, that was not meant to be in 2022, early 2022.
Okay, so you've got Kraken, Chinook, Cascadura, Coho. So why is Royston called Royston? Since you
Yeah,
enter your seas.
it's we do come up with the names. Most of them are fish. They're either Canadian fish or Trinidadian fish. Royston happens to be my dad's name. He was in the patch for a long time, and he was a true explorer. And it's not very often that you get an opportunity to name wells in our business. And it seemed apropos for somebody that spent his whole life in exploration to name a prospect this size after him and give it a shot. So I'm pretty excited about that.
Okay, Mr. Grewal asks, Paul, work started on preparing the road to Royston, and have you decided which drill rig will be used for Royston?
Yep, as I say, we got the sort of the final approval from the environmental just yesterday. So we're green lighted to go on that, and like bridge repairs and all the other stuff. But we're going in on an old road, so it's not really building an entire new road. It's really grubbing out the old one and making sure we can get past on it. And yes, we have committed to drill with a rig that's on the island. It's Well Services Rig 60. And it's a big rig, and it hasn't drilled in a while, but we're pretty comfortable. Those are the same company that's drilled all our other wells, and we've got a really good relationship with them, and they run a good operation. So that's what we'll be using. So as I say, we're on schedule, and we start to get to that nervous stage again now. So that's good.
No finger biting, I hope. But you are flush with cash. And Daniel Shaw asks, are there any plans to acquire further acreage near the Ottawa block?
At this point, no. I think with what you see there, we've got, it's pretty well defined. The fairway is pretty well defined, where the turbidite fairway is. It gets much thinner to the north and doesn't exist at all to the south when you get down towards Nevada. So we are kind of in the sweet spot. And quite frankly, with what we've got, we just don't see better opportunities than what we have right now. So we're just going to focus on what we have, and quite frankly, we've got, as I say, 10 years of opportunities. So we're going to have to prioritize even on our own business. And what's changed from what we've talked about a while ago, Sarah, was we used to talk just about exploration, and now what we've got is we've got these development. So you're going to have these two aspects of going on in 2021 and 2022. So you can have development at Cascadura and hopefully at Chinook with the test results. We'll have exploration going at Royston. So it's going to be a lower risk balance program going forward.
Okay. Have you ever felt like being greedy with the exploration?
I'm not sure what that means. I think there's always amount of sort of a little bit amount of greed when you do the exploration, because it's high risk, right? It's actually kind of a crazy business we're in that way. But I think there's a manageable way for us to explore the block. And the best way to do that is to use the cash that the block's generating to further explore. So again, it's that little bit of patience from shareholders. What we really want to do is get some of this gas on to fund the program, because we, quite frankly, just don't want to do any more dilution. We think we're done with that. We can now self-fund the program and manage it. So that's our concept.
Okay, Murray Chancellor asks, is there a license time limit on exploring the prospects? You've said earlier that it's time that's the biggest challenge. You're against the clock.
Yeah, so that's a good question, Marie. The exploration phase of the license actually Was supposed to expire in October of last year, but we got it extended through to July of 2021. So we want to make sure that we get, you know, a number of these exploratory wells drilled, because then they convert to development. You apply to convert them to development. But our plan would be at some point maybe to go back and talk to the ministry, commit to a bunch more wells, and see if they would look at extending again the exploration license. And we've had some discussions with them on that. Excuse me, no promises that that would happen, but it's by far the most efficient way for us to keep moving forward. But it is a good question.
We have this one every time. Any interest in a company wanting to buy you? I think it's...
Yeah. At this point, I can honestly say no. I think, you know, everybody has to be a little realistic. Like, it's very, very early on, right? Like, we really only have a test at Coho and a test at Cascadura, although they're fantastic tests. It's very, very early on. You know, we still need to test Chinook, make sure the concept's holding up there, the second Cascadura well, and moving out to Royston. So, you know, as I say, it's very, very early on in the process, but I can equivocally say no, there's been nobody that's talked to us about it at this point. I think you're on mute, Sarah.
Yes, I was being very foul-mouthed. It was okay. So it was deliberate. So obviously you haven't been gagged by any NDO or any potential takeover offers have been concerned. And I'm afraid we've run out of time again, because we've got several hundred here. There have been almost the same amount of questions put towards you. So if you wouldn't mind, if we could do a follow-up video in the coming weeks so that everything gets covered.
Yeah, that'd be great. We'll just sort of consolidate some of those questions and do that. That'd be great. But thanks again, Sarah.